That's what I was just holding up to.
Daughter on June 8th, Justina, who is at the happiest place on earth, Disney World, right now. Her birthday is June 9th. Mary Pratt, wave your hand. Mary Pratt's birthday is June 11th, and she'll be 25 again. You got to tell me how that happens. And little Miss Sydney in the back reminded me that her birthday was May 21st. So we need to sing happy birthday, y'all.
Happy birthday to you. Even with masks.
So I am inviting us to join in the prayers of the people, and I'll recite the opening part and then share in the prayers that we have and ask folks if there's anything we'd like to add in and contribute, and then we'll close in the prayer together. Amen.
Yes.
Holy God, you have called us to follow in the way of your risen Son and to care for those who are our companions, not only with words of comfort, but with acts of love. Yes. Seeking to be true friends of all, we offer our prayers on behalf of the church and the world. And this week, we are holding up in prayer Mary Catherine, Pat's sister-in-law and Valerie's aunt, Jan Whitfield, Joyce Gatlin, Doris Green, Carolyn Lewis, Josephine Gross, our dear Margaret, Barbie Hargrove's niece Peggy and nephew Lyndall, Pat Craig, and the Jefferson Street Bridge residents and anyone who is camping at this time, and also the residents at the Mosaic Residence who I believe are facing like severe home conditions and also evictions still in the middle of the pandemic. So we'll also at this time open up the floor and see what additional appreciation, celebrations, and prayers folks would like to share. Ingrid would like to celebrate her nephew, baby Luke, who came home with Avery and Emily last week. Amen.
We want to continue lifting up Richard Burton in prayer as he continues to recover.
So continue prayers for Richard Burton and his recovery.
My friend Glenn Douglas Tubbs, Ernest Tubbs' nephew, passed away. I have no idea. They've never really said what happened, but he is in heaven now. And his wife, Dottie, I know she could use everybody's prayers, because we know how hard that is. They were soulmates. And just pray for the Tubb family.
Since 1968, I think, and so it's kind of an emotional thing, and we'd love for us to keep the Tennessee Annual Conference in our prayers, and also as we grow into a new conference together, that's just as exciting. So it's not sad that it's happening, but it's just a bittersweet thing, I think.
So prayers for Tennessee Conference, again, as it is coming to a close as its own individual conference, and as we're growing and expanding and how we're interconnected in a conference in the United Methodist Church. Bailey?
Also, Calvin and Annette. Annette is having back trouble.
Calvin and Annette, and Annette's back pain and her healing. Okay, if you will join us in prayer together. God, guide us in the path of discipleship, so that as you have blessed us, we may be a blessing for others.
Bring the promise of the kingdom near by our words and deeds.
Amen. Amen. And we will now go forward in our scripture And if you like to follow along in the Bibles and pews, the scripture for today is Mark 3, verses 20 through 35. I tease Will for choosing the longest reading in the lectionary today, and that is all right. And amen. We go as the Holy Spirit leads us.
That's right.
And it reads, "And the crowd came together again so that they could not even eat. When his family heard it," Jesus' family, "they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, 'He has gone out of his mind.' And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, 'He has Beelzebub, and by the ruler of the demons, he casts out demons.' And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. 'How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, the kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come.'"
Yes.
And we should be throwing a party. "But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whomever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they have said, 'He has an unclean spirit.' Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, 'Your mothers and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you.' And he replied, 'Who are my mother and my brothers?' And looking at those who sat around him, he said, 'Here are my mother and my brothers. Whomever does the will of God is my mother, is my brother and sister and mother.' The word of God for the people of God."
Thanks be to God.
Yeah, thank you, Joy. I did not realize how long that was until I heard it being read out loud. Good morning, everybody. For those who haven't seen me without a mask before, or maybe have only seen me behind a screen, I'm Will, and I've been interning with Glenn Cliff for the past year. I'm a student at Vanderbilt. I thought I'd be nervous to give the message, that did come true, but I'm also just really happy to be here. I'm happy to be here in person, honored to get to share the message today. And I'm really excited that the lectionary text for this Sunday is from the Gospel of Mark. I got to take a class on that this past semester, and for the longest time, it's been my favorite gospel. Mostly because of how confusing it is. It's a weird gospel. We all know the cliffhanger ending where we don't see the risen Jesus and the women flee in terror. In the class, I realized just how weird the healing miracles are, where he'll like lick his fingers and put his fingers in a person's ear, and it's just very odd. There's the part where he says he speaks in parables precisely so that people won't be able to understand him. And if his goal was to confuse people with his parables, then it worked, because after 12 weeks of studying this gospel, I was still left with a lot of questions about it. And in our passage for today, we have yet another interesting or unexpected or strange thing happening. Jesus has been performing miracles throughout the whole gospel. He calls demons by name and he casts them out. And my thought would be that people would jump and shout and celebrate, like Joy said, throw a party at the sight of these miracles. But many times when people see Jesus doing these things, they instead get scared or they get upset at him. When he actually addresses the demons, people tremble. They ask by what authority Jesus does these things. They ask him to leave. And in this case, from our text for today, people say that he must be possessed by the devil. They say, how else could he name demons and have power over them? And in response, as we saw, Jesus is recorded as saying, if a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And then, even further on in the passage, toward the end, he says that it's only those who do the will of God that are his siblings. And for all the mystery that marks Jesus seems to have, and that's really the reason I love Mark's Jesus, he really seems to be rather bold and outspoken and clear in this passage. I think I deeply relate to the people who are questioning Jesus in this text and who are disturbed by him, because I too, a lot of the time, so badly want to misunderstand Jesus. I find myself being kind of intentionally obtuse because I'm afraid of what Jesus might be asking me to change within my life. I find myself wanting to pretend that he's mysterious or confusing, even when he's speaking so plainly for us. And in today's scripture, there's really not much wondering who he is or what he's about. In all the confusion of people suggesting that he might be some kind of demon, devilish figure, he outrightly swears off the demonic, and he swears his allegiance to God. And when people tell him his family is over there waiting for him, he very directly states who his people truly are. And it's ironic because Jesus says, a kingdom divided cannot stand. But one could say he's being just a little bit divisive here. He's saying, this is what I am, and this is what I'm not.
Yes.
And this is who I'm with, and this is what I'm against. And really, this whole passage, the more I read it, it's a little bit about division through and through, or a lot of it. And I'm reminded of the accusations, this is where my mind kept going, reading this passage. I'm reminded of the accusations that justice work is divisive, that people are sowing division when they speak out or make demands on behalf of people. And this text kind of tells me that, yes, the pursuit of justice is bound to get a little divisive at times, because we're expected to quietly participate in and go along with injustice, but things get controversial when we decide to actually talk about them,
yes,
to name them, to cast them out. The last time I shared a message with you all was actually over Zoom, and it had to do with the parable of the sheep and the goats, and I hope you don't remember it too well because it's a very similar message to what I'm giving today, which I realized when I was toward the end of writing. I think I was kind of repeating myself a little bit. But I really do hear the same message from today's scripture, that to work for justice inevitably means to pick sides and to side with the God who sides with the oppressed.
Yes.
And that's what it is to name demons, or to expel demons, or to call spirit-filled people your siblings in Christ.
Yes.
There are too many demons to name here in Tennessee nowadays, with the horror story of terrible legislation. Joy brought up the Jefferson Bridge encampment where people are being evicted. And legislators and parents and school boards have banned critical race theory in schools. There's been a slew of anti-trans bills, a law that would have made it legal to drive over protesters was being seriously considered. The people's budget has been working for a budget that privileges people over profits, over cages, over property. people gratefully have been working against. Some have rightly called it a slate of hate. And it leaves me a little winded to just name a few of the things. But it makes me think again about Jesus's words, where he says, a house divided against itself cannot stand. And I feel that we need to ask ourselves if we want the same old tired house to stand that privileges property and profits over people, or blatantly disregards people's dignity, or that clearly, from the things I just listed, has white supremacy as its rock and foundation. And I come to church because we, the church, at our best, see Christ as our rock and our foundation. I think of that psalm that reads, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
Yes.
And I believe that we, the church, especially this church, which I've come to love so much, we gather together because we all want a new foundation to be laid. And we have this shared mind and vision in which the love and dream of Christ is the cornerstone of whatever it is that we build.
Yes.
In the words of an old hymn that takes me back to my years at church camp, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Yes.
And so I'll leave you all with this, this last little thought. To prepare for this sermon, I was looking at some visual art based on the lectionary text. And for the passage about a house divided, there was a sketch of a big palace with water coursing through it and around it. And it was hard to tell the tone of the piece to me. I couldn't really tell if the house was being flooded, if it was being torn apart, if it was this gentle, beautiful stream flowing through it. I couldn't tell if it was meant to be exciting or kind of foreboding. And it got me thinking of the many different powers of water and how it's both destructive and creative. It can come down as a great flood, the way the prophet Amos calls for justice to roll down like a mighty stream. Water holds, carries, and it sustains life. It's needed to nurture growth. It uproots, it washes away debris and leaves new things in its path. It cleanses wounds. So I ask us today to reflect on these examples and more, and I ask us to embody water individually and as a church, as a people gathering together. In a house divided, let us be the mighty stream that brings all that living and rushing water brings. So, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Everybody else does it.
watching God, and we confess that we do as well. We listen to those whose promises are sold to the highest bidder. We idolize celebrities as if they were teachers of ethics. We long for that one person who will make everything right once again, once and for all. Is it any wonder we are a disappointed people, God of hope? Forgive us for turning our backs on you, even as you continue to stretch out your arms to us. Forgive us for trusting in those who prove to be false, rather than having faith in your love. Forgive us and fill us with the spirit of faith, which is given to us in Jesus Christ. Do not lose heart. God seeks to strengthen our souls, filling us with forgiveness, wonder, and joy. Glory to you, God of mercy and grace. You want only the best for us. And so we sing your praise. Thanks be to God. We are all forgiven. Amen. May the God of steadfast love be with you.
And also with you.
Siblings of Christ, lift your hearts to God. Catching a glimpse of goodness and beauty, you, God, shattered the stillness of chaos with your imaginative word and your spirit of faith, moving and transforming, shaping and creating. What had not been seen before sprang forth, suns and moons spinning in the galaxies, rivers racing one another to the seas, gentle rains whispering in the breeze. This garden of wonders and hopes we shared with those you created in your image. But we wanted to do the things our way and forsook you in the temptations offered to us by sin and death. You, however, would not forsake us and sent the prophets to us with words of hope and grace. But we rejected their words as having no meaning for us. Still, your love was steadfast, and your faith for us did not diminish as you sent Jesus to call us back to your heart. With those whose faith is strong and firm, and with those who struggle to believe, with all of every time and place, we sing our songs of thanksgiving to you, O God. Holy, holy, holy are you, God of our hearts. All creation and praises you with words of hope. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes and strengthens our souls. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, God of hope and forgiveness, and Jesus Christ is your love made human. He could not have come to divide us, but came that we might be one with you and with our siblings. He could not have come to judge us, but came to pull us out of harm's way. He could have come to defy us, but came to reject death and sin's claim on us, defeating their power once and for all. So as we remember how we have turned our backs on Christ, and as we hear his invitation to this very open table of grace, we speak of that faith in which we believe. Christ has died, showing us the way of obedience. Christ
Christ is raised, showing us the way of new life. Christ will come again, showing us your glory.
You surround us with your care, stretching out your hands upon those gathered in this very place, and with those who cannot be with us. Your Spirit transforming ordinary gifts of bread and juice into grace and hope. We taste the bread and drink from the cup and notice what we have not seen: the hunger of the world, the loneliness of those around us, the child with no hope, and we do not lose heart, trusting that you will use us to serve these needs around us, so that grace upon grace might be shared with our siblings. And when you stretch out your hands to lead us home, and we are gathered here together around the feast of the Lamb, which we can only glimpse in this moment, we will sing of your steadfast love and faithfulness forever and ever. God in community, holy in one. Amen. And now, if you all will come forward as you are able to receive grace and hope from Christ, everyone is welcome. Thank you for being patient with our very sanitized Jesus. Join with me in the prayer after Holy Communion. On this day, let us leave with thanksgiving in our hearts.
Going to share God's love with everyone we meet.
On this day, let us speak of what Jesus has done.
Pouring grace upon grace into all the lives around us.
On this day, and share the light and love that we believe.
Singing glad songs of the Spirit to our silenced world. Amen.
We've all received so many gifts from God this day. We have the help to get here. We have the transportation. We have so many things to be thankful for, and while there's so much suffering in the world, let us give back so that others may know the grace and love that we ourselves know. Will the ushers please come forward? I just love our ushers. The hug jug offering is our offering to help those who have financial needs, and so that is our little Sydney's, the bearer of the hug jug. Let us pray. Most loving and holy God, you've been so gracious to us, and you're gracious every day, generous every day. God, help us to pattern our lives after you. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen.
east nor west. And if you prefer the hymnal, that's number 548.
To love your neighbor. Amen, and go in peace.
Amen. Amen.